Hey everybody, welcome to Meaningful Mondays with Melanie. Today we have such a special guest that is joining us, and he's going to be talking about some of the effects of hip-hop, or should I say the hip before the hop, and its relation to corporate America and the prison industrial complex, something that is long overdue and something that we really need to hear more about because our young people are out there moving around aimlessly because they don't know have enough information. So today we have with us Father Amdi of the Watts Prophets. Father Amdi, are you there?
Yes, I am.
How are you feeling this day?
I'm feeling pretty good.
Good. I'm so glad that you're willing to share your insight on this topic because, you know, the youth today are getting the information from each other, and a lot of times that's not good because they don't have enough information because they weren't around at the time that this hip-hop industry came into play. So thank you.
Well, that's right, but I've been around since it started.
That's right.
The Watts Prophets, you know, the word rap or the genre as they did it in the record industry, there was no such genre as rap. Mm-hmm. And the Watts Prophets did their first album in 1969 called Rappin' Black. And that's where the industry got the name or the genre for the genre rap music.
So, that's right.
And you know, it started out, it was started by poets.
Yes.
And it started out as social commentary, different than it is today.
Right. So that album was called Rap in Black in a White World, correct?
Yes.
Yes. So that's something that a lot of us don't know about. A lot of people think that rap started in on the East Coast or, you know, in all these other areas. But,
well, you could say it did. Because you had the Last Poets on the East Coast and you had the Watts Prophets on the West Coast. And we were both, you know, that was just sort of something that came from poets, rap. And rap was a colloquial word that we used to mean talk.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what the Watts Prophets were doing. And that talk was social commentary.
Yes, absolutely.
But one thing before we get started, I would like to say, this is not an attack on the youth of hip-hop and some of the great poets in hip-hop. This is a dissecting of hip-hop and corporate America, the owners of hip-hop. They control the content, the distribution, the advertisement, and the...
Are you there, Father?
Yes, I'm here.
Oh, okay. I think your phone went out for a second. I didn't hear
I'm trying to call.
Oh, okay. Okay, I'm glad you mentioned that, the dissecting of hip-hop. That is probably the most important because people will assume that it is an attack. And, you know, a lot of times we fear what we don't understand. But, you know, for you to be able to bring us some insight on certain things. I know that we had talked previously about how you can take some of the things that are happening in hip-hop and you can see the direct correlation on how it disassociates you with what you've learned at home from your parents.
That's right. And carefully in increments, it sort of separated us from our culture, tradition, and history in the African-American community.
Yes. So I like the way that when you break it down, you start with you could take the body and you start from the toe and go all the way up to the head, and show the relationship or the disassociation taking place in this dissecting of hip hop and its culture.
Yes. Well, yes. the black youth in America are some of the most influential youth on earth. They're trendsetters, style setters, and it seems like corporate America keyed in on them to develop hip-hop. And the first thing they did, as I said earlier, was they separated it from its fathers, meaning the Last Poets and the Watts Prophets. I often wondered why they never mentioned us. Yet they had taken one of our art forms, which we called rap, and used it. So the first thing they did was separate it from the fathers and their style of presenting poetry.
Mm-hmm. So,
let's talk about it like this, if we could. Let's talk about an empty bag called hip-hop. Now, this bag is empty. And rap was put into this bag. The first thing they did is it was an art form, as I said earlier, of poets. And they came and they put the poets out and they changed their title from poets to DJs and MCs. Poetry didn't need a new name. Poets didn't need a new name, but they gave him a new name, DJs and MCs. Now, that was the first thing they did. Then they took our black, and they took that rap, and they put that in this bag, this empty bag. Then they took black visual art and called it graffiti art, rather than black art, which had a very deep history, our black art. Then they took black dance and they placed it in this bag, but they didn't call it black dance. They called it break dancing. Then they went to the studio. Wait a minute. Did I say black? I said graffiti art. And I said, did I say black dance? Did I talk about that? Black dance.
Yes.
They took black dance and called it break dance. Okay, yes. Then they moved to the studio. And they removed the heart of black music, the drummer, and replaced them with a drum machine, a highly scientific instrument that can control behavior. And you can kind of see how it controls behavior, because every time you turn on beats, all the heads start bobbing. Well, if I can make every head bob, I can make you kick somebody if I want to, I think.
Right.
Because that's a form of control, a very scientific instrument that we know very little about other than it makes beats. So again in history, the drummer was banned. This is not the first time the black drummer has been banned. And I don't know how you have black music without a drummer. Then they came back to the studio and removed the musician and replaced them with a technician. Stunning long history of black great black musicians. We went from Duke Ellington to cats who can't even read music. Now they had this soulless bag. It had no soul. So they say, we got all these elements. We got their rap. We got their dance. We have their visual arts. Now they, but this bag has no soul in it. So someone who ever created this said, I know what we need to do. We need to get the Isleys, James Brown, etc., in the name of sampling. And they were able to bring some soul to this soulless bag and also cut in on artists' intellectual property. Hip-hop was born and presented as black music. It was presented also as black culture. But what it was doing to black culture is actually blocking a movement of black culture that had started in the 60s. and was mm-hmm. developing slowly. We were getting cats like Dr. Ben, Dr. Sabi, et cetera, talking about our history and our culture and our tradition. But suddenly here comes this thing called hip-hop, which captured our children. Okay. You can ask me some questions now if you like.
Okay, so I really love the direction that we're going in when we talk about how, you know, then came hip-hop and started to capture our children. But before we get into how it captured our children, can you please expound on the concept of the hip before the hop?
Well, I don't understand what you mean, hip before the hop. I'm saying that our music was hip. We didn't need the hop.
Okay,
That's what I was saying. We was already, and hip-hop wasn't a new word for us, because mm-hmm. if you were raised on the West Coast here, and every dance that you went to was called a hop.
Right.
When my parents moved here from Louisiana and Texas, they were doing the Texas hop, the mm-hmm. bunny hop, et cetera.
Then we had the
Many a days back in the 50s, me and my wife walked out of a hop and turned to each other and said, that show was a hip hop. Because mm-hmm. we added hip to everything that was hip during that time. If you had on some hip shoes, we said, that show is hip. Those shoes so are hip. That show is a hip car. You sure have a hip woman, et cetera. Mm-hmm. We put hip on everything that we thought was hip. Often said, this sure was a hip hop.
Yes.
But the youth of today think that's a brand new word coined by, I believe, African Bambaataa or someone.
Yeah. I remember growing up listening to my mom have conversations over the phone. And right now, when we have conversations with our friends, we're like, okay, I get it or I understand. But my mom used to always say, I'm hip. You know?
Yeah, that's right.
That means that she was, you know, in complete understanding of what the other person on the phone was saying, you know.
That's
so,
right. That's right. We sound hip to that.
Yes. Yes. So, and I guess where we were going with it before, then came hip-hop. So after they've taken all of these original art forms and then coined a completely different phrase to what was already in existence and, you know, are removing the drummer and removing the musician and, you know, removing the heart of Black music and bringing in these different things that they wanted to coin it that we, as, you know, me growing up, I was familiar with graffiti art in more than I was with the term visual art and breakdance more than I was with the term Black dance, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, even in working in the music industry for a while, we were more familiar with the term DJ and MC more than we were with the poet.
Mm-hmm.
Not being
able to... Who was the father of all of that.
Yes, exactly. And that history is just not being told, you know? So the whole idea of hip-hop coming in after all of that, after the sampling, after the soul and the intellectual properties that, you know, they wanted to bring in. We then talk about how, you know, the things that our parents told us at home, what to do and what not to do, and how, you know, the hip-hop culture, I guess I could use the word culture lightly, has taken our children to the space where it would be disobedient to what the parent had already told them, like pull up your pants and tuck in your shirt and tie your shoes.
That's right. And if you remember, one of the first big groups that came out was Run DMC and the Beastie Boys. But
yes.
Run DMC, if most people I ask about their first memory of Run DMC was, they always mention Adidas shoes.
Mm-hmm.
And I often ask them, what about those Adidas shoes? And they were untied. That's mm-hmm. the main thing about them. And the tongue was hanging out.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the first things you learn as a young child is how to tie your shoes. And it was very important to families that their children tied their shoes. And if you left the house tried to leave your home without your shoes tied, all the elders in the house would say, tie those shoes, girl, or tie mm-hmm. those shoes, boy. But hip-hop showed one of its main artists with his shoes untied. So they started with the feet and putting us in a uniform, just like a police uniform or janitor's uniform, except sailor's uniform. These children were systematically put in a uniform. First, the shoes untied. Then they moved up to the pants, sagging. Now, our parents never liked this. It was like being separated from our parents in increments. Our parents said, tie our shoes. Hip-hop said, leave them untied. Our parents said, pull our pants up. Hip-hop said, let them sag. Then they moved to the neck. Everybody had to have some gold or something of expense, some expensive piece of jewelry on their neck to be hip-hop. Then they moved to the head, and they turned the hat sideways or backwards and pushed that. Then they begin to tattoo the arms, from the arms to the hands. But when they found out that that could be covered up, they begin to tattoo the neck and the face, etc. Now, dressed like this, which and then you had groups like Crisscross, who actually put their pants on backwards, which would really drive parents crazy if their kids begin to walk outside with their pants backwards. But dressed like this, my question is, where would you go in America and get a job with your shoes untied, your pants sagging, your hats turned sideways, and tattoos all over your face? Mm-hmm. You were actually in a uniform sold mm-hmm. to you by hip-hop artists, because mm-hmm. every hip-hop artist today has something to sell you. If it's nothing, they're selling you shoes, they're selling you pants, they're selling you underwear, they're selling you liquor. They're selling you many, many, all of the things that it takes to be hip-hop. And it's really very expensive to buy Timberland boots, et cetera, and stuff like that. So now they have them in uniform where they can recognize them a mile away. Mm-hmm. And why did they want to recognize them? I say they wanted to recognize them for the development of the prison industrial complex.
Yes.
That's the only thing that's left for a person who has his shoes untied, his pants sagging, his head sideways, and tattoos all over him. So mm-hmm. this also irritated the elders in the black community. Each of these things separated us from our elders. Because we were known for dressing. We were known for being sharp. All you have to do is look at the artist of the 50s and 60s and even the 40s. They were known for dressing.
Yes. And, you know, Baba, or Father Amdi, our people are such a cool people. Like, we got a strut about ourselves, and we got a stroll, and you know, like you say, you know, there was a particular way that everybody dressed, and you know, we're very proud of that. And when it came to this culture of hip hop, what we saw happening, if we can take it back to the Adidas, you know, starting with the feet, we noticed that, you know, when your shoes are untied, you kind of walk with a limp. It's not that same cool stroll that you see a brother walking down the street with. And when you walk with that limp, that also represents the ball and chain that's wrapped around your leg in the prison industrial situations, you know. So it's very interesting how we can take all of these things that you listed from the head to toe and show how it could directly correlate with what's going on in prisons. I know that they say that in prisons they make you take out your shoestrings and they take off your belt so that you don't commit suicide. But what happens is that, you know, we find ourselves feeling like we have this weight around us. Our pants are now sagging. So when we come home from out of the prisons, we're on the streets now with sagging pants because of what was going on in the prison.
That's correct. Much of the dress came from prisons. And now youth are even having trouble with their hips because they have to walk with their legs kind of abnormal, in an abnormal way. You know, you're not walking normal to hold those pants up.
Yes.
And it's causing health problems as they get older.
Yes. This also brings us to the conversation of corporate America and how corporate America benefits from this uniform that we're wearing. And it kind of shows a correlation between corporate America and the prison industrial complex and shows how they kind of work together.
That's right. And they have us already in uniform where we are clearly recognizable and ready for prison.
Yes. I remember when they implemented certain laws like Operation Nutcracker or the curfew that they had for not just the youth, but even people who were over 21, and they would use this uniform as a way of saying that you look guilty of something or, you know, giving the cops an excuse to pull you over or stop you while walking down the street because you were dressed a particular way and you looked like a gangbanger or a thug or something. And that correlates with this uniform that we spoke of.
That's right. And the hip-hop artists sell the youth those uniforms because just about, as I said earlier, every hip-hop artist that's visible on TV, on radio, etc., he has something to sell you, if no more than some pants, some drawers, some alcohol, some earphones, some Timberlands, whatever they're selling. Each one has something to sell you that goes along with dressing you in this uniform.
Mm-hmm.
And they also push one more thing that I don't want to talk about, and that's cursing.
Yeah.
Black people curse just like anybody else, but we didn't do it in public. Mm-hmm. And we, at that time, called black women queens, sister, lovely, etc. But over the years, the Watts Prophets Watch changed to bitch, whore, lot lizard, etc. Mm-hmm. Whatever degrading name, they begin to push cursing.
Mm-hmm.
And if you listen to many of these records, every other record, every other line is a curse word. And they begin to push that. One more thing they begin to push along with that was gang banging.
Mm-hmm.
And they push that in every little hamlet and every little community across America, not just across America, across the world. Because everybody that listens to hip-hop that's really hip to it or listen to it a lot, they know that a guy like Snoop Dogg came from the Crips. Kyle like Game came from the Bloods. Everybody knows that. They're in those colors a lot when they are presented to us. So this uniform became a very diabolical thing. And as I said, it spread it cursing, which the word cursing means to curse you. It means cursed. And that's what when you continue to cultivate cursing, and particularly among young people who seem to feel that it's all right, well, when you curse your whole atmosphere.
Yeah.
Because the flesh of a word is the breath of the one who spoke it.
Yes.
So every word that you speak, every curse word that you speak, lingers. negative atmosphere all around those that continue to curse. And this negative atmosphere, it stays there. In other words, it's the breath, the flesh of a word is the breath of the one who spoke it. In other words, every word that you speak has a little bit of you in it, because you can't say a word without air, your breath. So when you curse, every curse word that you send out, the flesh of that word is the breath of the one who spoke it.
Mm-hmm.
So you pollute your whole atmosphere, and it doesn't go away. So you can pollute an atmosphere. Just you can see the effects of negative words. Say MF around decent people or people who do not respect that word. And you immediately see a reaction. That's what curse words do. They bring a reaction, usually a negative one.
Just wanted
to put that in there.
Yeah, when you know, I'm glad you did too, because when you talk about the head to toe effect of, you know, this this hip hop industry, you mentioned the headgear and how, you know, instead of wearing, we would wear the hats sideways or backwards. But then you later on mentioned headphones, and now that is the new headgear. And with these headphones, that's where we're hearing the loudest aspects of this language that's going directly back into our social or our consciousness, you know? So we start to regurgitate these words. And it, like you said, the flesh of the word is the breath of the one who spoke it. So not only are we hearing it back in our heads, but now we're regurgitating it and we're saying it. So we're giving it more flesh. It's almost like a human being birthing another human being, and it's being done through words. So
that's
the youth
right.
are picking up on it, and they're regurgitating it, and they really don't know the meaning of it.
And the effects of it, that it's actually polluting their atmosphere with something that's actually almost tangible and measurable, because you can measure the breath in a word with an instrument, with the right instrument. So it's...
And, you know, another thing that I would like to touch on, Baba, is I remember once we were all in the studio together, and while we were in the studio watching a recording session, we realized that nobody had pen and paper anymore. Nobody was writing down their lyrics, and everybody had cell phones in their hands, and if the battery in the cell phone died, they couldn't go in the studio and record.
That's right.
And that was a little disturbing.
And it wasn't, and that's not writing.
Right.
It's not developing the technique of writing.
Mm-hmm.
Most artists write their work out or type their work out. But when you have it in the phone, it does spell check and all the different things that it's supposed to do. So go ahead.
I was just going to say, you know, when you're typing it in a phone, a lot of times people are using the text language, which is not the correct spelling of any of the words. So it seems like this could also be some type of way promoting illiteracy.
It is promoting illiteracy.
Okay.
Because, they, you know, like you say, they're not using the word, they're not spelling the words correctly. There's no punctuation. Most times, so yes, it's retarding us in a way. I said like that.
Yes, and our language is so important and so powerful. And when we deal with the fact that, you know, our language has been stripped from us, and we're watching it, you know, be further stripped from us, and the energy from our language being stripped from us too. We see these effects happen, and I know that when you deal with hip-hop culture on the East Coast versus the hip-hop culture on the West Coast, not to divide it, but just to for sake of conversation, you know, sometimes we'll travel and we'll find out that they're using words that we've never heard before. And or we're using words that they've never heard before. They're like, what does that mean? You know?
Mm-hmm.
And it takes a while before all of the language catches up across the world, you know?
Mm-hmm. I agree. Hip hop and hip hop polluted our image across the world.
Mm-hmm.
People think that everybody is walking around, African American youth is walking around with the image that we have described. With the shoes untied, the Timberlands on, the pants sagging, the hat turned sideways with still the label on it, etc. Who pushed these things like this? Corporate America. And it's had an effect on all Americans, not just African Americans.
Yeah.
They polluted our image. But that image had, that pollution had a ripple effect.
Mm-hmm.
Their kids are walking around now with their pants down, with their heads turned sideways.
Yes.
And I don't consider it black music at all.
Mm-hmm.
Without the musicians and the drummers, how do you call that black music? It's coming back now. Because corporate America sees that they need something new to keep this going. So now they made full circle. They took the drummer out. They took the musician out. But now the hip cats like Jay-Z and different cats like that, they're coming back to the instruments.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.